the only reason to give a speech is to change the world. With less than 10 minutes, our goal is a bit more modest. We tackle the greatest obstacle to innovation, fostering readiness for change. And mind you, innovation is not just coming up with new ideas. You get no credit for brilliant ideas unless you can implement them. Executives execute. An idea is not an innovation until it has been successfully implemented and add value. And change initiatives is the mechanism to convert ideas into implementation. As students, you should appreciate the fact that 91% of human resource directors say that by 2018, just 3 short years from now, people will be recruited. You will be recruited based on your ability to successfully manage change and uncertainty. That will be the USP, the unique selling proposition for you in the job market. So how do we ignite innovation? How do we move from a type S static organization to a type A agile organization? First, we must overcome individual resistance to change and establish organizational readiness for change. So the framework for our conversation over the next 7 minutes is the axiom of persuasion. Never a statistic without a story, and never a story without a statistic. Here are 3 data points for your consideration. 60%, 70%, 49.3%. 60% of CEOs say that innovation is the primary objective of their company. 70% of those innovations fail. And 49.3% are the odds of winning rolling dice at the crap tables in Las Vegas. And so you have a better chance of winning in Vegas than you have of your change initiatives succeeding. Employee resistance to change is the most common reason cited by CEOs and other executives for failure of organizational change. Failure to establish sufficient readiness for change accounts for half of all unsuccessful change initiatives. Now keep in mind, we can never force someone to change. They need to overcome their resistance to change. And you need to get inside the head of the resistor, inside their mind. So now the story. In the spirit of popular TV shows such as Criminal Minds, we bring you Changing Minds, the profiling of a change resistor. For those of you not familiar with profiling, here's how this works. Say that someone is murdered, most likely a married woman. Well, first we think it's the husband or the boyfriend. And then the profilers construct a portrait of the unsub, the unidentified, the unknown subject, the likely offender. And so we will now give you a snapshot profile of that change resistor. We'll start with some geographical profiling. What's their country of birth? Well, we're pretty clear about this one. Our unsub likely comes from the small Western European country of Luxembourg, where the official, and I kid you not, the official national motto is, We want to remain as we are. We want to remain as we are. More than 500,000 people, born and bred to be change resistors. While the mantra of most companies is change or die, our resistors' motto is we'd rather die than change. So we know where they were born. Where do they live now? What is their current residence? Our resistors are cave dwellers. Cave, C-A-V-E. That is, they are constantly against virtually everything. Right? And you know this, as you've all observed, if you want to make enemies, just try changing anything. It doesn't matter what it is. You start suggesting a change, and before you can finish, they tell you all the reasons it's not a good idea here, maybe good elsewhere, but not here. We refer to this as the NIH syndrome, not invented here. The trap is a status quo trap, where maintaining the current situation involves the least psychological risk. Caves, like silos, are safe, secure, and insulated. The next obvious question is years on the job, their work situation. We're looking for someone who has likely been in the same company for 2.5 years, 2.5 years. The longer one has lived in a cave, that is, worked in an organization, the more resistant to change they are. What's their favorite subject in high school? Well, I think this one's pretty obvious. It's biology. And in particular, what we find is that they are huge fans of homeostasis. That is the biological process of keeping everything constant. Well, we need to get to the biggest one to identify our unsub, and that is phobias. Our unsub suffers from metathesiophobia. These people often feel that they have no control over their lives due to constant change. And let's be reminded that it's very natural in the evolutionary process of humans to resist change. It's a survival instinct. When we change, we feel that we lose control. With the phobic, mind you, the fear is irrational, it's excessive, and it's constant. The phobia is caused by a triggering event, usually a traumatic experience with a previous change initiative, typically in their organization. They feel that they must do whatever is possible to avoid change. The phobic creates a comfort zone, a cave, if you will, and they're unwilling to come out of it. And finally, you might ask, what is their favorite book? What will we find them reading? Having heard of a pending change, there is a clear pattern that resistors follow. It begins with denial. Oh, I can't believe they're really thinking about this change. It must be a mistake. You must have heard wrong. It must be a rumor. And then they move from denial to anger. I can't believe they're making this change. How dare they do that? And then it moves on to bargain. Well, maybe if we say we'll do this, or if we agree to do that, they won't make the change. And then depression. Enormous depression and pain about this change. Does this sound familiar? In Kubler-Ross's wonderful, wonderful book, which I commend to everyone, on death and dying, she identifies five stages of grief. Five. But I gave you only four. What's the fifth stage? The fifth stage is acceptance. This is where the change resistors diverge from the diet. Our resistors often don't reach the acceptance change. So our profiling has led us to the conclusion. to go right to the initiative and neglect to solve for the change part of the equation. Remember, our unsubs are dangerous. He and she are a constant threat to your organization's lifeblood. That is your capacity to successfully launch, lead, and realize benefits from change initiatives. Our experience tells us that when it comes to treating these phobics, we overestimate our ability to change others and underestimate our need to change ourselves. The metatheophobes' personality may not be interested in getting help. Why? Because it means a need for change. So as current and future leaders, your objective, which is always innovation, your objective is to modify the unsub's perception of change. If all else fails in treating this anxiety disorder, you have a final option, a last resort. Sometimes, if you want to change the people, you need to change the people. You either fire them up or you fire them out. I urge you to proceed, but to proceed with caution. Good luck. Thank you.